now and forever. Transform darkness into light. Through the blessing of this glorious Sunday, make us worthy to praise you with all those who saw the radiant light of your resurrection. We worship and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Spirit, fill
fragrance through our good works and actions. Hear our petitions and grant rest to our departed in your dwelling place of joy. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
As chastised, and yet not put to death, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet enriching men, as having nothing, and yet possessing all things. Praise be to God always.
Through the heart of every man, woman, and child born into the earth.
And of course, we see the resulting fractiousness around, the dissatisfaction, the purposelessness in many people's lives. They don't see the direction. So there's this kind of underlying angst, this underlying agitation. But none of this is what God originally planned. This division in the human race, this division among nations, this fracturedness, this brokenness, this woundedness, is not God's original intent. To the contrary, not even the division between flesh and spirit that runs in the heart of every single individual, between the higher activity of grace of the Spirit of God and simply human nature weighted here below. That division, even that, was not God's original intention. This is what St. Paul is meaning when he writes to the Corinthians. Last week was a letter to the Romans. This week he's writing to the Corinthians. And with the Corinthians, what he's insisting on here is reconciliation. God's intention is that everything which is fractured now and wounded is still meant to come together as one. And so all of chapter 5, all of chapter 5 in 2 Corinthians is about reconciliation. How God desires to bring Jew and Gentile, the nations together into this renewed humanity, which is the body of Christ. But even more profoundly than this is that we talk about man being created in the image of God. And it's true, it's in the scriptures, it's in Genesis. And the way, in the Western tradition, the way it's explained is that idea of the ability to know, the human mind to know, and the human will in perceiving goodness to love. And that is the reflection of God's image in human beings. And as far as it goes, that's true. But St. Ephrem and the Syriac fathers go further in the East. And what they say is that mankind, Adam and Eve, we're not created only in the image of God in the sense of intellect and will, of mind and heart, but that human beings were created in the image of the Word incarnate. That it was God's intention from all eternity that He Himself would enter into His creation. Because everything's about unity. Everything's about union. Everything is about oneness to be brought into the one life of God, who while being three persons is only one God. And so God's intent for the Syriac fathers is the creation of mankind in the image of His reality in the future to enter His world, of joining divinity to creation, of God and man. And of course, subsequent to the fall, our Lord's entrance into the world, Christ incarnate, is also for redemption. But the original intention was simply the unity, bringing into the divine life. God Himself chose to enter into nature. And with that in mind, when He created man and woman, when He created Adam and Eve, He created them in the image of Christ incarnate, of the Word incarnate in the future. Now this is an important and fundamental idea, because the restoration of grace is not just that our minds work well, that our hearts are turned towards the good, but that our destiny is to imitate and be transformed into Christ. From the very beginning in paradise, this reality was always there. Adam and Eve, as we know the story, Adam and Eve repudiated this. And they clung only to their nature. They repudiate spirit. They do not want that aspect. But what it means then is from that moment on in the creation of the human race, the destiny of every human being is to become, we can say, Christian, to become Christ-like. That is our destiny. Now, as long as we cling only to human nature, and we only cling to our own needs and our wants and paying the bills, as we keep talking about, we are blinded to the grace that God is trying to accomplish in us. So that when God entered into time and history and our divine Lord in Christ, that work became not only a manifestation of the Hidden One in creation, but now it became redemptive, to restore, to redeem, to purchase back and to restore and to heal what mankind itself had distorted. So that when we look at sin from this point of view, what sin is first of all the clinging to self. I choose what I want to do. What Adam and Eve do in the garden is saying, we will decide what is right and what is wrong for us. The knowledge of the tree of good and evil, we decide what is good and evil. We decide this. That is the essence of every sin. No one will tell me what I'm going to do. And so what that does is that begins the distortion of the divine image, because that is not the image of Christ, is it? The one who came into the world to give his life for others. The one who came to heal, to preach good, glad tidings to the poor in the gospel of today, and to give sight to the blind. And with our Lord's coming into the world, he restores to us his image. Now, you may be aware already, but in Vatican II, there's a phrase in which we are said, and it's an unusual phrase because it's unique in recent history of the Church. They say that the fathers of the Council said that Christ entered the world in order to reveal man to himself. Now, this sounds very strange. Because, of course, we know that Christ comes to manifest the hidden Father. He comes to manifest God to the world. But that one phrase, even though it's by primarily the Latin fathers of the Church, the Latin bishops of the Church, is completely in correspondence with the Eastern Syriac idea that when Christ enters the world, it is not just to manifest God, but it is also to reveal to human beings what their destiny was meant and should be. Become in this way of self-giving. It restores that image which had been distorted by the selfishness of Adam and Eve. And of course, that selfishness of Adam and Eve brings an accumulation of darkness, which is why the human experience throughout history is error. There are a lot of beautiful things that the human race has done, but there is also a lot of rubbish, a lot of error, a lot of hatred, a lot of scorn. And that is an effect of this accumulation of darkness in the selfishness of the distorted image by original sin. And of course, all of this error and darkness and ignorance and selfishness leads to self-destruction. That we live in a world now where in the last 40 years, in America alone, we have killed 60 million children by abortion. That we are told that suicide is an epidemic across the country. Week after week goes by, and this actor, or this actress, or this journalist hang themselves, kill themselves. There is something fundamentally wrong that is clearly being manifested to us. But it is that distortion of the image of God in man, that accumulation of darkness and error which results in self-destruction, which is why St. Paul says in his letter to the Romans that the wages of sin is death. He doesn't mean physical death. We all die, both the good and the bad. Everyone dies. It's not that death. But it's the self-destruction of wantingly holding on to our own identity, falsely thinking that's the source of our purpose. But our purpose in existence is to become Christ-like. And that is the importance of the divine mysteries. And you are to be congratulated that you're not laying out in a hammock in camp this morning, that you are here. Because you understand that the divine mysteries are this transformation week after week. Because the idea of becoming Christ is obviously, first of all, overwhelming. But that is the personal destiny for each one of us. And to the degree that we fall short of that, we enter self-destruction, what we call hell. That's the logic of how this works. So that our Lord gives us this contact physically, poured water in baptism, oils in chrismation, bread and wine transformed into the body and blood of Christ in communion. This physical contact is to give us access through the human nature of God incarnate, so that we ourselves can be transformed to the people that we are supposed to be, which are created in the image and likeness of the Word incarnate. This is the idea of reconciliation in the epistle today. This is the idea that when St. Paul says that we are ambassadors, speaking of the apostles, speaking of the stewards of the mysteries of God, that we are ambassadors appealing to you to hear the voice of our Sovereign and to be reconciled in the Lord. It is a very beautiful image. Last week was a bit bleak, I suppose, between flesh and spirit. But this is the couple together to understand that we have to have that understanding of flesh and the spirit and that division and understand the reconciliation that is laid before us to be able to come to this. And so that what we have today is a very beautiful vision of St. Paul and one of great hope, but also at the same time a bit overwhelming. Because if my individual life would truly become Christ-like, what would that be? Would that lead me to martyrdom, like today's commemoration of Saints Kerapos and Iolita, martyrs of the Syriac tradition? Would that be that I die in obscurity, but in a profound transformative life of our Lord in contemplative prayer? We don't know. But we do know that it will be better than mediocrity. Simply bobbing along is not what God has created us for. So on one hand, there's kind of this fear, sense of awe, that if my life truly became Christ-like, what would it look like? Because I can't imagine where our Lord would lead us. But on the other hand, it's one of great hope, because that is beautiful. The idea of being transformed in the image of the Word incarnate as a destiny, as a purpose of my existence, is beautiful. And that has been God's intent from the creation of the world. This is the Syriac notion of the return to paradise. This is the idea that we return to what God desires us to be. And that God allows us to have this contact through the Eucharistic sacrifice, through the Divine Communion, through the sacrament that initiates us through baptism to begin this journey. That is a very hopeful thing and a very beautiful thing and a gift. Which is why St. Paul finishes by saying this epistle, now is the acceptable time. He's quoting from the prophet Isaiah in the Greek version of the Old Testament, which is about the servant Messiah, the Christ who will come, who will bring the nations of the earth together, who will reassemble and restore Israel to its former glory. But of course, its former glory now is transformed into the new Israel, which is the church. So in quoting Isaiah, when he says that now is the acceptable time, it's reminding us that salvation is not something that happens when we die, but it's something that happens today. Like I said, your better choice between the hammock and the Eucharist, you have chosen the better part. Because now, today, is the moment that begins this transformation of grace within us. And that is a very wonderful thing. So I leave you with a quotation at the very end of this chapter 6 of St. Paul. Because he finishes by saying to the Corinthians, he says, our mouth is open to you, Corinthians, meaning I'm ready to teach you and to do everything I can do for you to follow this path. And our heart is open wide. You are not restricted by us. In other words, Corinthians, if you find yourself kind of crippled, hobbled on this pathway, I'm trying to make it as open as I can. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted by your own affections, the things that you cling to, the things that you love, the things that you make principal and importance in your life. But he finishes by saying, Corinthians, following imitation of him, he says, Corinthians, widen, expand your hearts also. May God give us the grace each to do this. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Oh,
Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and divine love, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, Holy Altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O Minister of God.
And each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Father, O Lord, hear.
Blessings that you bestow. for your good and rich in graces, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, civil leaders throughout the world, that they may stand for justice and establish peace, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your holy church that you established on a solid rock of true faith, and send your vocations to the holy priesthood and religious life. In a world of distractions which pull us away from properly loving you and our neighbor, may those who have called to serve your holy church respond to you and have the courage to follow your will. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who pleased you from the beginning, especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured sufferings for the sake of your church and of your people. May we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to the rest of the kingdom, awaiting their life-giving voice, calling them to life. Accept the offerings we present to you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us the power to die, and forgive us if we have been, with the powerful knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us in the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was in time, shall be forever. Amen. My God,
the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit. Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask Him for mercy and compassion.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you and deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries of purity and holiness. That through them we may be forgiven and made holy, and we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
Grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, and forever.
With your spirit, let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask Him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for He is one in heaven and on earth, to Him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy blood, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. It's our communion to be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name, and that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you receive from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.